Kerwin P. Slippers here.
And Taryl!
And we're back with part four of the custom Resto-Mod of our RJ58 that we got, right?
Yeah.
The Wheelie Horse.
The Wheelie Horse that we've been working on. So, we went to start to rebuild the transmission on the RJ, and it's garbage.
Not looking good. As in junk.
Somebody took a grinder to this case, so this isn't going to seal. And they also took a grinder to these axle shafts and these keyways. And then we got to thinking, me and Slip Dog, that this transmission probably wouldn't have been strong enough anyway with all that horsepower we're adding to it. And we also have that other RJ with the transmission is bad in that one too. So we may need parts from this to fix the other trans. So between the two transmissions, we can make one good one when we go to do, that's going to be a restoration. That's all going to be original, right?
Yeah,
So started putting our heads together. My head, his head. And then we had a third head, which was that elkskin head that was hanging on a wall. And elkskin said, hey, I think I got the solution, and I think I got the transmission that you need. And that transmission is right over there. Slippers, you want to unveil the transmission?
All right, let's see what we got under here.
It's another Wheel Horse transmission from a different model. I think he said it was from a 62. And we think this will work good because it's heavy duty and it's about the same width. And we shouldn't have to do too much modifications to make this fit where the other one did. So what we're going to do is get the RJ over here. And we got our lift. And I got my shackle in there. We're going to lift this up. And we're going to kind of strap it to the frame and see how it looks. All right. I just took a ratchet strap and strapped it around the transmission and strapped it to the frame. And it looks pretty good. I put a level on it and it is sitting a little bit lower in the back. It ain't sitting perfectly level, not by very much, but that's even better yet. We want it a little lower in the back, but you can't tell. And you know, those are the wheels that was on the live axle that we started with. So now we need to mount this to the frame. So on the front of this transmission is four mounting screws where it mounted to the original Wheel Horse model that this came off of. So I've got some of this 6-inch wide plate, 1/4 by 6-inch wide plate that I welded across the bottom here. So I'll have to make a template and should be able to weld the plate to the angles down here to here, you know, to the angle down here. I'll get a piece of plate and show you. And then we want to secure the back of the transmission. Now this was for the hitch right here, and I could tell that somebody, this pin is frozen in there. And somebody drilled holes in here and put some kind of lubricant or PB Blaster or Freol or something in there, and it didn't work. So we'll have to do the heat quench. We'll take this pin out, and then I'll make a couple of tabs that we could weld to the frame down here. And then that's still gonna, we still got enough metal hanging off the back here for our wheelie bars. And elkskins also We don't know if we're gonna use this stuff. Here's the, you know, I put the side bolt in here so we can lift it up. So here's the two screws for the seat. So the seat will mount back there like it did originally. And look at our shifter. Look at it.
Yeah, no interference.
No interference with the engine.
Or the seat.
Or the seat. So we don't have to modify any of that. Perfect. So this should be a pretty simple installing this in place of that other part that I made. Now I know what you're thinking, I can hear you. Taryl, you went through all that work to make that other part on there, that was like a big waste of time. No, it wasn't. It wasn't a total L. I could use this on something else that I could build in the future. You know, this is all one assembly that I made that bolted to that frame. So I got a live axle set up with bearings. And I can put whatever hubs I want. These are the RJ hubs, which were 3-bolt. I think we'll just use the 5-bolt ones that are on there, Slippers.
Yeah, that's fine.
And then again, from VMC, you know, this brake that we got, I got a brake set up, this brake set up, so I can build me something else, something cool. Something that sits low to the ground with a torque converter and all that I know is going to work. But hey, that's the fun of trying all this stuff. Just see if it works or not. We're not engineers, are we, Slippers?
I don't think so.
We're hillbillies, and he's an old man. So you got a hillbilly and an old man.
Exactly correct.
So yeah, I got some of that plate. This is a piece of that plate left over. So I can put that in there and mount it to the front. And then I still got a bunch of this 1¼ by 1/4-inch stick, flat stock. So I'll get me, you know, my favorite template, some 30 brick cardstock. That'll make me a couple templates. And we'll get this transmission mounted. And what else did he give? Oh yeah, Elkskins also said from Elkskins Junkyard. Elkskins Lawnmower Junkyard, that's his channel. Now we don't know if we're gonna use this stuff, but he had it anyway. He had the toolbox, because you know these RJs had fenders and toolboxes. So he's got the toolbox, which goes this way. And then the fender's mounted to that. Oh. But we don't know if we're going to use it. I kind of like the open wheel look, don't you?
Yeah, I do too.
If anything, we might just use the toolbox. Because Slippers is a tool. Well, we can mock that stuff up and see. All right, we spun the engine around. And we were able to use the same slots that I'd cut in there from when the engine was facing the other way. So we only gotta do minimal modifications to that. One of them being, when the engine was the other way, I mounted a solenoid up under here because all the electrical connections were in the front. Now all the electrical's in the back. So luckily, I had one of these, which is a Briggs & Scranton part. Solenoids that bolt right to the starter. So we got, you know, this goes here. So we got room back here to mount this. So that solenoid will be hanging down there or up here. We'll figure out where it's gonna go. We had to take the oil filter off. Let me get that part.
Good. I don't like oil filters on these babies.
By me, I mean me. So the oil filter, because this thing is slotted, we may have to move it back and forth. You know, there's room for it when we got it all the way back. Well, not really. Very little room.
Yeah, get rid of it.
So luckily, Briggs and Scranton makes a block off plate. So this plate basically takes the oil and diverts it through this channel. So we can eliminate the oil filter.
But I really planned on putting at least 40,000 miles on that engine a year.
Oh.
So I probably need that oil filter. Yeah,
you're right. There's push mowers don't have oil filter. A lot of these small engines don't have oil filter.
Yeah,
that's,
I know.
It's not a big deal.
I didn't think so.
So, yeah, Elkskin said they make a block off plate. I didn't realize that. So that's what the plate is.
Well, that worked out good.
It's just got a slot cut in it so the oil will go out and go back around. Now, if you wanted to make your own, you could get an old oil filter, or you could take the one off. Say this was in the way of your project. You could take this off. You could cut this. Cap, 1/8 pipe cap, the two holes. Put some 1/8 pipe plugs in there. And then just take some kind of tool and grind a slot in there. Just like they did here. So just go between these two holes and grind a passage so the oil can divert itself. And then since you cut this here, you're gonna have those two openings. Just tap them 1/8 pipe tap like this and put a couple of pipe plugs in there. Now you just made your own. I could have did that, but since they have the part, they already make it, I thought I'd just buy it. Now you're probably wondering what that hole is for. That's for the pressure switch in case you wanted to put an oil sensor in there for oil pressure, or if the oil got low, you can make it turn a light on. Or in some cases, you could rig it up to where it would shut the motor off. That's what that little port's for, in case you were wondering. What's that port for, Taryl? Why is there a hole in there? That's for the this. So we eliminated that, so now we can slide the engine forward. We're just gonna have to take the fuel line. We're gonna have to put our original valve covers back on so we can have the oil cap back here. So we'll swap these. We'll go take these off and put the other ones back on that were on there originally. We'll just have to run a longer fuel line to the fuel pump. And since our choke is here, we'll probably just run a choke cable, a little short choke cable to one of these holes that's in this cowling so we can choke it. And then the only other little modification we're gonna have to do, we're gonna put the battery up there. Contacted our friends. At Interstate Batteries in Fowler, Indiana, our local distributor, Kevin and all the guys and gals there at Fowler Interstate, thank you again for the battery.
Yeah, that's awesome.
They love our channel. They love helping us out.
Yeah, thank you guys. You guys rule.
So we got another battery that's going to go here. So I have to run a battery cable from there, where the solenoid's gonna be, back to here. So, in part two, remember when I extended the frame in that, I welded that piece of, 2-inch or 2.5-inch angle iron underneath here? So all I gotta do is drill a hole back here in this plate to find that piece of angle iron that's welded up underneath there, and I can run that cable right through that piece of angle iron like a chase, like a piece of conduit. And that way it'll protect the cable, it'll be inside there. And you won't even see it. So yeah, that piece of 2-inch angle that I welded up underneath there to stiffen this, it's got two purposes. And then there's just one other modification. So now the exhaust is coming out the front, which is how it did originally on the RJ. You know, when we had the motor spun the other way, the exhaust was coming out the back, which was kind of cool. So now, to make it simple, it's going to come out the front.
Looks like it's hitting a little bit right there.
But the only problem is it's hitting on this support for the hood. So I started thinking about that, and I came up with a solution for that. Again, with another piece of 2-inch angle, you know, like I ran underneath. I'll either run a full piece like this, or I'll cut it to the width of 1¼ inches. But we'll find out where this lays on this support here, and then I'll weld this to here, and then we'll just cut that piece of support out that's in there. So it acts like a little deflection for it. That way I don't have to mess with cutting this and bending it, when I could just simply weld this in place and then take my wizard wheel and cut this piece of steel out, and that exhaust will pass right through this piece of angle. And then these are just pulleys that we had laying around the shop. I don't want to start buying pulleys because I'm not sure what gear ratio we're going to go with. So we'll just use these pulleys to start with, and then figure out what we want to do for that. And then we'll just move the pedal. The pedal was over there on that side. We'll just move it over to here. And rig up another idler setup. We could probably use this one over. Might just have to modify it a little bit to get it to work again. To put tension on the belt. We'll see how that works. And now the steering. Let's talk about the steering.
Here's the good stuff right here. I'm waiting for this.
Alright, come up here, cameraman. Alright, the steering now. We got this link that goes from one kingpin to the other one. And then you got your center shaft that's got this other link here. And that's what turns it. So we're going to do away with all that. We're going to get rid of this. Get rid of this. We'll keep that block under there that this rod goes to. And I'll just get a piece of plate and weld it to that block. And then I bought these on eBay. These hind joints. And then I found somebody that was selling this. These are half 20. That's the thread size. Half inch fine thread. One side's left-handed, one side's right-handed. Then I went to the hardware store and bought a couple of jam nuts. You only need the one jam nut on this side. So now, we'll tie it like a quad does. We'll put these to each kingpin and to that plate in the center. And now when we want to adjust our toe, we just loosen that jam nut and turn this in the center, and it'll walk it in or out. I think these were made for like lawnmower racing anyway. Another problem. In these kingpins, that hole is 3/4, and we're going with 1/2 inch. There's going to be a 1/2 inch bolt going in there. So we need to put a bushing in each one of these kingpins. This is a spanner bushing for a wheel for a John Deere, probably a zero turn mower that I got from Rotary. It's 3/4 on the outside, 1/2 inch on the inside. So I'll cut this, make me a couple of sleeves to drop in there to take up that gap. And then I might even weld them in there. And then that way we'll have our little bushings. So it'll take up that slop in there. Sounds like a plan, huh? So I made my templates, And then again, I just stuck this up to the transmission and took the pin of the hammer and hit it over the hole to locate the hole. Then I put a bolt in there to hold it, the template. Then I went and did another one. That way I make sure that it's going to be accurate. Punched another hole, put a bolt in it, went down here, located that hole, tapped on it with the hammer until it cut a hole in it, put a bolt in there, made sure everything lined up, and then punched the last one. Then I just transferred this to here. Now all I got to do is cut this. And then the same thing with this template. Drilled 3/4 hole in there. And then I had to fit it after that. So you can see when I made my template, it was a little long, but that's good that it was. And then I just slowly ground it to fit it in there. So I got a nice fit. And then I beveled it real good. So when I go to weld it, make sure we get good penetration. Now we're gonna heat and quench the back of the trans to get that pin out, because I'm gonna put a 3/4 bolt in there. We're gonna eliminate that pin.
I think we should have tapped those holes and then put some Zerks in there and then greased it up and then tried to drive it out that way. That would've been fun.
That wasn't gonna work, Slippers. The thing is rusted in there.
It would've been cool though, right?
Now, whenever you're heating up cast iron like this, you gotta be careful, because if you get it too hot and cool it too fast, you will crack it. So we're not gonna get it cherry red, we're just gonna get it hot enough. All right, Slippers, fire away.
All right.
Whoa. Cool down, baby.
All right, we don't want the great flood in here.
There's a drain right there. Keep hitting it.
Oh.
Pull it down. Blew it off a little bit. Now we'll spray some of that PB in there to kind of help it if we get it to move. And I'm gonna use my brass hammer so we don't mushroom it. Moving. Now let me tell you a little heat quench story while we're doing this. There, it's moving now. One time I had a guy, feller, came in and the receiver hitch on his pickup truck was rusted into the hitch of the truck. And I told him to do the heat quench trick. Heat it up. I go, you got an oxygen amphetamine torch? He's like, yeah. I go heat it up cherry red and quench it with water. It'll come right out. That'll never work. Oh, whatever, dude. I got it a come along hooked to a tree, putting tension on the receiver hitch, and I've been going out there every day and spraying it with PB Blaster and whatever he was. I go, just heat it up and quench it. Oh, I tried heating it up. I had that thing cherry red and it wouldn't come out, it wouldn't budge. All right, whatever, keep doing your silly little come along and spraying it with penetrating lube. So another guy went over there that we know and he goes, hey, why don't you just do like Taryl does and just heat and quench it? I don't think that'll work. He goes, go get the torch. Went and got the torch and the garden hose. Guy went out there, heated it up. Now this has been going on for like a month. Him with the come along and the spraying it every day, and the thing didn't move an inch. So this other guy goes, get the torch, go get a garden hose. heated up cherry red, hit it with the garden hose, gave it a few whacks with a hammer, and the thing came right out. All right, once you get it knocked loose, you still gotta use the PB Blaster or WD-40 or whatever you wanna use. And a file I'm using, because in case this end of this was raised up from somebody beating on this pin, you know, I wanted to make sure it wasn't gonna get stuck. But it's moving real free now, see? So I've been filing on it and working it back and forth. I just want to make sure when I drive it out, it's not going to get stuck on the end. Make sure this isn't all mushroomed up. Here it comes. Wow, there's your dinner. I said it works better when you can heat a cherry red and then quench it, but again, because this is cast iron, if you cool it too fast, you will crack it. All right, so now I got my tabs installed in my 3/4 bolt. So that's how it's gonna look. Once we get it lined up, and it's not lined up yet. If you look at the trans, it's kind of crooked. But I'm just showing you what we're gonna do here. Now, Slippers, would be a good time to drill and tap and put a grease fitting in there so that this bolt would never get stuck in there. Then you could grease it occasionally. But that's how it's gonna look. And you know what else I forgot to show you? Which I should have did as soon as we mounted the trans in there. Because you got to remember to see it's just being held on with the ratchet strap right now. But now that we got differential action, like before in part 3, when we had that live axle, you know, we weren't going to be able to turn it. I just thought we could power through it like a quad, but the weight distribution was all wrong. You need to be sitting over the engine or have the engine more towards the back for that. But now, see, now it'll steer. Oop. Now we can steer it. And it should still wheelie, even though we're gonna have one wheel peel. We'll have a little bit of a trans is moving all around.
Well, I plan on driving it 100 miles a day, so.
Yeah, so you're gonna be putting a lot of time on it.
Better be ready for that kind of stuff.
I know a lot of people don't like the position of the engine. You know, they wanted us to put the engine under the cowl. Well, that's not an RJ. We wanted the engine under the cowl, we would have got another wheel horse.
Yeah, different one.
This is a nut roaster. That's why they called it a nut roaster, because the engine was right there. So we wanted to do the same thing. And some people commented they didn't like the engine being in the middle like that. I don't want nothing like that between my legs. That motor blows up. Come on. Never rode a motorcycle? The motor's right underneath you the same way. You're just sitting up a little higher. And engines don't blow up like a bomb. When these things throw a rod, it punches a hole if it's revving high enough down here. As you can see, when it threw the rod, it started to punch a hole in the block. It doesn't blow up like a bomb. The heads don't come flying off. This isn't some alcohol-fueled small engine. There's no risk of any of that happening.
Oh, the exhaust is too close
not
to your
what
leg.
What we're doing with it.
Yeah. The exhaust is too close to your leg. Again, never rode a motorcycle?
Yeah, it's right there.
Exhaust is right there pipe. By your leg. Actually, this exhaust will be closer in than a motorcycle. Well, got the transmission in place and squared up. And then if you don't know about squaring things up, you measure diagonally from corner to corner and then adjust it. So there's a bit of a gap on this side here, but I can fill that in with weld. But it was real, real close. So now I'll unbolt it, pull the trans out, finish welding these tabs and that plate in the front end. And then I went ahead, drilled a 3/4 hole in here. And then again, like I said previously, to meet that 2-inch piece of angle iron that I ran from front to back to support this plate, which is what we did in part 2, in case you're just tuning into this series. So when I built all this, I put a piece of 2-inch angle iron underneath to strengthen this. So that's also gonna work as like conduit for this battery cable. So that worked out good. And then I got a little bushing here that can go in there to protect the cable. And then I'll put some heat shrink around here. And then this cable is a little long, so I may trim it off and put a different terminal on the end for the battery. And then I went ahead and put that solenoid on, secured my fuse. I also added a little connector here just in case Slippers wants to add some kind of lights or something.
Yeah.
So now we got power through the fuse so we can add something. And I got the solenoid hooked to the starter. And I put that diverter plate on. I shouldn't call it a block off plate because it's not, it's eliminating the oil filter, but it also diverts the oil. So we got that on. And then I marked over here where I'm gonna cut that so our exhaust can go through there. And then I'll just go ahead and weld this piece of angle there. Because that exhaust pipe hits right on here. It's not right in the center, but it's hitting it enough. And I wanna give it a clean look. You know, I don't want to bend it out or bow it out. So I'll just cut this piece out. We'll weld that on there. And it should look good. I think I'm going to leave it overlap like that instead of just cutting a piece that's that width. That way it'll kind of act like a little bit of a guard since you're going to have your foot here. Then we can get the engine mounted back in and start working on getting the belt hooked up. And then Slippers, you know, he just sits there in the background and just shakes his head and nods in agreement.
Exactly correct.
Watches me work. Okay, we got the trans axle mounts welded in. And we got our little, I don't know what you'd call that, little exhaust breather welded in there to give some room for the exhaust pipe. Now I can put the transaxle back in. We can put the motor back in. Got my heat shrink on. My battery cable. Got our little bushing in there. All right, Slippers, make yourself useful and guide the transaxle back into the frame.
All right, bring her down nice and easy. Whoa, whoa, whoa. Oh, nice and easy. Oh, there it is. There it is. Look at that.
I thought it might have pulled a little bit when I welded. I might have had to beat them tabs, but I guess I welded it right. Welded the inside first and then the outside and then pulled it out.
Good job. Now, if we would have went with my awesome idea of putting the Zerks back here and greasing it, we'd still be waiting to get that pin out, and that'd be awesome.
Well, we could drill and tap one of them holes now and put a grease fitting in there.
That's not fun.
So this
bolt's already been done.
So this bolt won't get stuck in there.
I wanted to sit and wait for months.
Look at that. Almost like we knew what we were doing.
Yeah, looks like it was made for it. We're gonna have to get some sort of skull to go on top of that shifter. It's gonna be sick.
Well, we got the engine back in and the seat on. That wasn't too difficult to make that transformation to this. Now we just gotta hook up a brake. I got some brake material coming to reline that brake band. We'll probably use a cable and again another brake lever from like a motorcycle. And then just hook up the throttle and put the battery in. And then we just gotta put our belt on there and make our tensioner. And then we'll be trying it again to see if we can get it to wheelie.
Yes, hopefully it'll work this time around.
Well, we've been playing around with the pulleys, trying to get the gearing right on this. So this is what we came up with. We went back to this real big pulley that we did earlier in part three. And a little tiny 2-inch pulley here. And that seems to work a lot better as far as speed. So off camera, we used those other pulleys and it only went as fast as a regular lawn tractor. And another thing we discovered is we don't have any third gear. It won't lock into third gear. So at some point we're gonna have to pull this trans back out, pull it apart so we can get it to lock into third. It won't lock all the way in. And then we're gonna go back to the original clutch setup that the RJ had with that other trans, where they went with the idler on top of the belt since we switched everything around. And this is what we've come up with so far. So I made this little bracket here. This was some bracket. It was like we'll show you a picture of it. It was a hitch off of something. Some little garden tool or something that I robbed off of there. And it had the right centers on it. And then I welded these pins on there. So now when we start it, the belt and everything won't turn on us. We still gotta hook up a choke at some point. So this is the clutch setup that I came up with. I've got a shoulder bolt in here. So this, and I got it kind of locked. It's kind of stiff, but it will give. And then if it doesn't end up working, I can always weld this solid. But it looks like it'll work. I want to keep this close back to here in case we need to increase this pulley size to get more speed. But we'll see how it works with this one. We can always buy a bigger pulley. That way, the bigger diameter pulley, a bigger belt, and our idler will always be back here. And that's basically how the original RJ was, where they ran a rod through the frame So we're gonna, I got this tack welded here and I need to cut this off, and I'm gonna cut it off with, look at this, my brand new Milwaukee cordless 4.5 inch, 5 inch grinder.
That sounds great.
Slippers and Junior bought this for me for Christmas. Wasn't that nice of them?
Oh, I think so. Definitely could use it.
Yeah.
Where's that Milwaukee sponsorship?
I know.
That'd be awesome.
Yeah.
They should be hitting you up. Giving
Milwaukee tools. Should be giving me these tools. I shouldn't, well, I didn't buy it, but these guys shouldn't have to be buying it.
Yeah, I think it's awesome.
So let me put my spectacles on. So I don't get nothing in my eye, and I'm gonna trim off this piece of rod, and then we can weld that solid on there. Now I can go and weld this, finish weld that around. So we're gonna need a spacer in between there. So I got a bunch of these, I don't remember where I got these little short ones. But again, these are those wheel spacers or spanners. And this one's for a grasshopper. And that's the rotary part number 140-60. It's 3/8 on the inside and it's like 3/4 of an inch on the outside. So I'm going to use these for the brake lever. And then I got a different half of my other two. It's that span, one of them spanner for a wheel. This one's 1/2 inch on the inside. So that'll work perfect for this. So I can cut me a piece of that and make me a spacer to keep this from moving on us. And then these I'm gonna use for something else. I'm gonna show you that in a minute. This is a 1/2 inch nut, and I'm gonna drill it out with a 1/2 inch drill, and I'm gonna score an X on here, because that'll find the center of this. I'll center punch that X, I'll drill and tap this nut, and I'll put a set screw in there. And then that's going to slide over this once I drill it out. And then I'll weld this nut to this piece of flat stock, and then that set screw will make it so we can remove this. And then with another piece of this, I'll make another spacer on this side. Now I know that this rod is going through this angle iron. I could put some bushings in there, but this is how Wheel Horse did it originally, and it lasted, what, 50, 60 years? Longer, over 60 years, and it didn't wear out. And again, we're not gonna be riding this stuff that much. And if it does start to wear, I could always pull this rod out, drill these holes out bigger, and put bushings in there. But I think I'm going to leave it like this, because this is how they originally had it. So I'll make a spacer. I'll make this so we can pull this off. We got this facing down. So what it'll be is it'll be like this. It's going to be about in that position, because we want one up and one down. So when we push on the pedal, it's gonna push this up, which is gonna take the tension off the belt. And then when we let off the pedal, the spring tension is gonna pull this down, just like a regular lawn tractor. So we're gonna go the opposite of what we did before. So when you jump on this thing, you'll push on the pedal, it'll take the tension off the belt, you'll put it in gear, and when you take your foot off the pedal, the spring is gonna pull the pedal back, which is gonna pull down on this arm and make the belt real tight, and then it's gonna pop a wheelie. So this is the 3/8 rod that we're gonna use for our pedal. And as you can see, I already modified the original pedal by adding this part and this part here, because I want this to be close to the frame for our rod, for the linkage I'm going to make. So I went to the hardware store and I picked up a bigger turnbuckle because I wanted 3/8 diameter. And I took the one, what did I do with that other end? Because I was showing Slippers what I was doing. Here it is. So this was the end that was in here from the hardware store. So I took that eye bolt out and I got me a piece of all thread and I cut it and it's in about that far and I welded it on. So that's going to go on this end. So when I determine the length of this rod, I'll cut it off, slip this on over the end and weld it on. Then I can put the turnbuckle on there. Now we can adjust this rod. For the other end, I'll take another one of these sleeves I got, and I'll take the other end of the eye bolt, and I'll cut this off some, I'll stick it in here, weld it, and then right where I got this bend, I'll cut some of this rod off, and we'll have this in there, and then we can bolt it to this. You'll see when it's all done. And then this was the tab that was originally on the RJ, and then we moved it and then I cut it off again. I'm probably going to take this tab and relocate it over here somewhere, and then I'll drill a hole in here, probably down here somewhere, and then we'll run our spring, our real heavy duty spring, to put tension on this. So that way there'll be tension on the belt the whole time. Just like it did original. Now we need brakes. So here was the original brake band, and that liner material was missing. So I went on eBay, my favorite store, and I found this brake lining material that's flexible, see? It flexes. This is brake lining, and it's the exact width of this. So we'll bond this to the band. Now, if you're interested in getting this material, it wasn't very much with the shipping. It was like $15 for a foot of this. I'll give you the name of the guy's eBay web store. J.C. Thingamajigs. And what this is called is flex molded brake lining. This is 3/16 thick, 1.5 inch wide. He's got all different sizes and stuff. So that's the name of his eBay store, JC's Thingamajigs. Very nice man. His name is Jim. He really helped me out with this. So Slippers, you can flatten this out with a hammer for me.
Okay.
Put it in the blast cabinet, sandblast it real good. So that way, when we bond it, when I cut it, I have to trim some off.
Gotcha.
We'll bond this, and then we'll put it on. We'll have our new brake band.
Sweet.
And then this is the handle I'm gonna use. I got this from Stenz, this brake lever, and then I got me a, Stenz also sells a brake cable kit. for like mini bikes and go-karts. There's the part number 26208. It's got this fitting on the end, and it comes with this clamp and a spring. There's a spring in there, a return spring. But what I'm gonna do is I'm not gonna use this. Well, look at that, it hopped up right up there. Never do that again. So I got the cable, and this is 8mm metric thread. So I took another piece of that 1¼ wide flat stock, and I made it a little longer. Then I drilled and tapped that 8mm. Let me see that brake band slipper.
No problem.
So that bolts on like this, the one end. Goes like this. This wraps around. This will be bolted like that. Our cable's gonna come through here. I'm gonna take this spring. The spring will be in there. So that way it'll return this, push back on it. And now I'm gonna close up that hole a little bit. I'm gonna use this washer. I'm gonna weld this washer on here. And then this is a retainer for a lawn boy, an old lawn boy mower for their cable, for that BBC cable, this one on the end of it. And that kind of fits in that notch real good in this washer. Kind of holds it center. And if you want the part number for that, because I got a bag of these, was 611-213. Get it, boy!
Yeah, that's awesome.
611-213, I got a bag of these little things. And then here's the part number for this lever from Stenz. 260-240 for this brake lever. So this will go through here. Oop, this will go like this. This will go through here, this will go through there. And then I'll have that washer on there, weld it through. And then this will fit right on the end of the cable and lock that in, so the cable won't fall off. Then when we squeeze the lever, it's gonna squeeze the band, and it's gonna stop the wheelie horse. You'll see when I get it all done. And then we should be able to put the wheels on and pop some wheelies.
Sweet.
We just won't have third gear to see how fast we go. And then I gotta make a battery box. So this is the battery box I'm making. This is some 2-inch wide flat stock that I got tack welded. And then that's gonna go right here underneath the battery. That'll be right there like that.
Sweet.
And then we'll put a strap going over the battery to hold it from jumping out. I just gotta finish welding it and put that in. So there we are.
Excellent.
We're getting close.
Yeah.
So now we gotta get cracking, as they say in England, on this linkage. And I'm gonna buy a new pulley back here. This was just pulleys we had laying around. This one doesn't have a keyway in it, but I did find one online that does have a keyway. But we're just going to use this one for now to see how our gearing works and see how fast it goes and see if it'll pull a wheelie. Then we can play around with the pulley some more. Okay, Slippers done sandblasted the brake band for me. So instead of welding a washer on there, it was a lot easier to just fill it in with weld. So what I like to do whenever I fill in holes with weld is I like to back it up with a piece of brass. So that way the wire doesn't shoot through the hole and it kind of gives it a little backing. So there's a little tip for you when you're filling in holes with weld. Back it up with some brass. And another thing, it's always important to have a drill gauge. This thing comes in so handy for sizing stuff. So here's that retaining clip. And I found what hole it fit in real good, and it's the 5/16. So I'll clean up this weld a little bit, you know, sand it smooth, and then I'll open it up with a 5/16 drill bit. And then that clip, that retaining clip will fit in there real nice. And then the next thing we need to do is just bond the lining to the brake band. I already went ahead and drilled out this half inch nut. So this is a good way to make some locking collars. This is a good trick. So you don't have to buy locking collars. You can just make your own out of regular hardware. So I opened it up, half inch, so it'll slip over that piece of half inch rod we got. And then I just took my little scale and my scribe and then drew an X on there so I can find the center of it. Now I'll center punch that little spot there with my little handy dandy center punch I got from Cousin Gerald. This thing is great. This is like the best center punch I've ever used. Then you can also whack it too. I don't know where he got it. You can probably find it online, but this is the best center punch I've ever had. And then I'll drill and tap it probably 1/4-20 and put a 1/4-20 set screw in there. And then I'll weld it to that piece of flat stock. So what I'll do is I'll just weld all the flats except for this one. Because if I weld this flat, it's going to build this up with weld and it might be hard to get at that set screw. So if I weld these other 5 flats, that'll be strong enough to hold it to that piece of flat stock. So there's another little trick for you, making locking collars. Okay, I got this little lever made up. There's that collar that I welded on there with the set screw. I kind of messed up. When I was welding it on there, I couldn't see too good, and I actually welded a little bit onto the set screw, but I was able to get it out and put a new one in there. And then I started on the link. I should have probably let it stick out a little bit, but I shoved it all the way in and welded it. So I had to clean it up a little bit and add a radius to this. And then I made my spacer out of that tubing, which I just cut in my chop saw. I'm sure you could probably use a big tubing cutter on that, or cut it freehand with a hacksaw or with a 4.5-inch grinder. Try to get it as straight as you can. So that's how this is gonna be. This is our spacer and our washer, and I wanted to make sure that was gonna spin free when I go to tighten this down, because we're gonna be pushing on that. I may have to redo this. I may have to buy another eye bolt and extend this collar out a little bit, because it looks like it might hit. But we'll see. I might have enough play in there. I might be able to grind this down a little bit. And I got the brake pad ready. I was able to cut it with a razor knife. And I marked it where I want to start. and I'm gonna use JB Weld, the quick set. And that's another good use for that old cardstock to mix on, and I always like to save old popsicle sticks. When I get done eating ice cream bar or something, I save these sticks all the time. They're good for mixing stuff up. All right, and then I got my clamps ready. So we'll bond this to here, and then we'll see if this is gonna work. Because when we activate this, like I said, this may rub on there. I may have to grind this back a little. All right, so I had to grind it down some instead of making a new one. I'm basically making a poor man's heim joint is what I'm making here. So now we got plenty of clearance on that. It'll swing. I did it on both sides just in case. Take it off and flip it around and then it starts rubbing on there, but that should work. We'll find out. All right, we got our brake installed. And I had to cut a lot of the material back to get this to work. And that's probably because the original brake lining was probably 1/8 inch thick, where this is 3/16 inch thick. So it took up a lot of area, which made it, you know, smaller. So out of that 1 foot piece, let me put my spectacles on. He used about 6 inches of it. About 6 inches of it. And it's about 3 inches from here. Now I probably could have left that other little piece in here, but I cut a little bit of that out. I could always add some back if I have to. And then I had to extend this. I had to make this longer and then bend it down. Because I had it pulling from here, and when it was squeezing it, this part of the band was rubbing on here. See how that's pretty close there? But it's pretty far away. And I've got some more of this material left, so I could take a little piece if I have to, and I can bond it right in this area if I have to, a little piece. But I think this will be enough stopping power. Because, you know, originally it had a solid steel rod that pushed on this brake band. But since we're using a cable, you know, we had to come up with our own. Again, it's all trial and error and uncharted waters here. So now we gotta make our link. So Mr. Cameraman, you're gonna have to get down a little low so you can show. All right, so I got this made up here. So about right here, we can got it right in the middle of our adjustment. So let me get my Sharpie pen out. And I can cut this probably right about here. So this is about all of this material, this 3/8 round stock I got here. This is about all I needed. I'll weld this in. Well, actually this is gonna get welded in over here. And then weld this in. And we'll hook up our spring. And then I gotta bypass the governor. Oh, I still gotta weld in my battery box. I'll take this battery box out and finish welding the edges, and then I'll tack it in place just to keep the battery from moving around. So we're getting closer to seeing if this thing's gonna work. Now I gotta bypass that governor spring. Gotta do my temporary bypass on that. And then once we get everything dialed in and we strip it all down to finish it off, paint it and all that, then I'll address a better throttle system for it. But we'll just do something temporary for now. So let me go ahead and cut this rod, get this all hooked up. Okay, we got the link all hooked up. And our spring. Got the battery box tacked in. So now all I gotta do is put the battery in, put the back wheels on, and I need to disable that governor so we can get some high revs. And for that, I'm just gonna take a piece of wire and I'm gonna wrap it around the governor spring, and just to keep the governor spring from stretching. That's my temporary disabling of the governor. And like I said, later on, when we pull it all apart, I'll come up with a different way of throttling this. And we'll see how this works. Well, we got it all together. Let's see if this thing will work and drive, or if it's another failure.
I hope not.
I hope not too. Yeah. All right, let's try it out. I got it neutral. Gotta warm it up.
Well, that was fun.
Put it in reverse. It already wore off that cheap pulley I'd put on there. That's all right, I was gonna buy a new pulley anyway. But at least we know it works. So I'm not gonna get another one of these aluminum pulleys. I'll get a good steel pulley. But hey, it wheelied, and it wheelied real easy too. I was a little scared, I didn't wanna flip over. And it went pretty fast in second gear. We gotta do some work to the motor. The motor ain't running that good. Fix that throttle, but we're getting there. We're getting close. Yeah, it wheelies, the wheelie horse. Well, it works.
We got it to Wheelie. We just got to iron out a few things. The brakes suck. We're going to have to maybe redo the brake slippers.
Yeah.
But it went fast in first gear, and I didn't get a chance to open her up in second. We got to work on that throttle a little bit. We need to do the steering next. We need to work on that. And we also need to find out why it won't go into third gear. But at least we got it to Wheelie. Everything seems to be working now. We're getting it ironed out, getting it closer and closer. See, this is what you got to do. You got to trial and error whenever you're building this stuff. It just don't go together, you know, like you plan in your head. You know, you see a picture of the stuff in your head and you think, yeah, that should work, that'll work. And then it doesn't work. And then you think, okay, got to rethink it again. So that's the fun part of it, as Musty says. And figuring it out. Yeah. Right, Slippers? So what do you think?
Pretty awesome. Not like a straightforward restoration like I always do. This is a lot more involved. I'm seeing firsthand all the little things you gotta do and try. See what works and what doesn't. So yeah, pretty awesome.
Fabricating and...
Oh yeah, a lot of cool stuff going on.
A lot of thinking, constantly trying to think. How about this? Let's try this, let's try that.
Got other people throwing ideas at you. Maybe you can try this, or what do you think about this? Maybe that'll work.
Yeah, we got some other stuff we got to do, like maybe move the ignition switch, because it kind of hits on the inside of your leg, the key. You know, so just little things. You got to hook up a choke cable. Just little tiny little things, you know. So, subscribe to this YouTube channel, Taryl Fixes All. That's me. There's you, Slippers.
That's me. Oh wait, that's you. That's me, right there. That's man.
There's Junior. He ain't here today. He's probably right playing with his cameras or his RC car. Follow us on Facebook and Instagram. Maybe show us your custom project that you're working on. Like to see that.
Yeah.
And go to our web store. Buy some of the products that we used in this restoration, or this Resto-Mod, or whatever you want to call it, this custom build. And as always, there's your dinner. Woo! Got it to Wheelie! And the Wheelie horse! Woo! And we got reverse.
Yeah, that's even awesomer.
And it turns.
That's it. Can't wait. Stay tuned for the next chapter. It's gonna just get even more awesomer from here.
Wheelie bars, we gotta get wheelie bars.
Oh, yeah, gotta get those on there too. That way you can really.
So we can hold it at a wheelie instead of trying to ride a wheelie on it. That's kind of scary. This thing's heavy. Man, this thing come flipping over on you. It'd be pretty heavy. Wheelie bars. Alright, I got real work to do.
Alright, just gonna sit here and stare at this for the next.